and how do we go about diagnosing it? So we'll talk about diagnosing Addison's disease now. So the three tests that we typically use to diagnose Addison's disease is, number one, we just check electrolytes. So electrolytes, we're talking about sodium and potassium here. The second test we can use is something called a baseline cortisol test, and I'll talk about what that is in just a second. And then the third test is something called an ACTH stimulation test. ACTH stands for adrenocorticotropin hormone, but we just typically abbreviate it ACTH. So what do we check for when we check electrolytes? So in typical Addison's disease, we're gonna see low sodium and high potassium. And this high potassium is can be life-threatening and something that we need to deal with immediately when our patients come in with it. As far as atypical Addison's diseases, we don't see these changes, right? I mentioned this earlier. Most veterinarians on routine blood work check sodium and potassium, but if you have a dog with atypical Addison's disease, you're not gonna see these changes on routine blood work that's performed. As far as cortisol testing, so cortisol testing is one of those things we don't do routinely, but can certainly be indicated if you have a dog that has specific clinical signs that could be consistent with Addison's disease. So the first test for cortisol that we run is something called a baseline cortisol. Most veterinarians can measure this in-house with kind of a SNAP test, which is a quick and easy test that we run in our clinics. It can also be sent out to a reference laboratory. And the way that this works is if your cortisol is greater than 2, that means that like your dog is normal and healthy and does not have Addison's disease. But the issue with cortisol, just measuring a single baseline cortisol, is sometimes the level of cortisol throughout the day can just fluctuate. I'm just trying to draw on the slide here, but obviously I can't really do that with a pointer. But here you can see my pointer going up and down and up and down. So if you happen to just catch an animal's cortisol at a trough, the baseline cortisol could be less than 2, but that doesn't mean your dog has Addison's disease. It means you need to follow up with a test that we call an ACTH stim test. Does that kind of make sense? Greater than 2 rules it out. Less than 2 requires a follow-up test. It does not mean your dog has Addison's disease if it's less than 2. Okay? And so what is this follow-up test, this ACTH stim test? So this is a test where we measure the cortisol, then we give an injection of this substance called ACTH. And what ACTH does is it tells your adrenal glands to make more cortisol. So if your adrenal glands are functioning normally, like mine hopefully are and hopefully everyone else is in the room, when someone injects you with ACTH and you measure the cortisol an hour later, it should skyrocket, right? Because you're telling the adrenal glands to make more. If your adrenal glands aren't working well, they're not gonna respond to that ACTH and you're gonna see a flat test. And I'll show you kind of what that looks like in just a second, okay? So here's basically what it looks like. So if you had so what you see here is you see a chart. These are actually dogs that come from my own database of animals with Addison's disease and without Addison's disease for research. So in affected dogs, you see this red line is this bar of 2, and these pink dots here, these red dots, are before the initial cortisol, and the posts that are in the blue are after we give the substance that's supposed to stimulate the adrenal glands. Can you see that it doesn't really change, right? So you give it, the adrenal glands don't respond. You don't see anything go up, whereas if you look at an unaffected dog, you have some population of dogs where the baseline cortisol is sort of ranging here, but some of them are low, but when you give the ACTH, you see they all skyrocket, so the blue dots go up, and that's normal because the adrenal glands are responding to the ACTH. So this is how your veterinarian would make a definitive diagnosis of Addison's disease if you have a baseline cortisol of less than 2, and hopefully your dogs are going to fall off this time. Does that make sense? Great. So how do we treat Addison's disease? So So Addison's disease, we treat it with two drugs. So the first thing that we treat it with is steroids. And the reason why we give steroids is it's designed to replace the cortisol, that hormone that the body isn't making. I know sometimes out there, there's some concern about, oh, I don't want to give my dog steroids. Steroids can have long-term complications. It can be problematic. It can cause immunosuppression, right? So in this case, if you have a dog with Addison's disease, remember, we all need steroids, cortisol, in our body. A dog with Addison's disease is not making any of his or her own, so you have to give it the steroids to replace what the body isn't normally making. We typically give a really, really low dose of it, which is just designed to replace what, again, what the dog's adrenal glands normally can't make. The other drug that we typically give to patients with Addison's disease is something called DOCP, stands for desoxycorticosteroid. It's sort of irrelevant to know, but it replaces that hormone aldosterone. We only give it if you have a typical Addison's patient because it's needed to rebalance that abnormal sodium and potassium. Aldosterone is, or DOCP is given as an injection, and it the steroids are given as a pill, and you give them typically once a day. The DOCP is given as an injection. It's given about once every 25 or 28 days. Usually owners will learn to give this shot to their dogs at home, but sometimes people don't want to get injections, so then you just have to kind of figure out, is your dog 25 days or 28 days, and then bring your dog back to your vet every month for the shot. There is an alternative, a pill called Florinef, that we typically don't use so much because it has some overlap with the steroids, and in some patients can be harder to manage. And both of these medications, so here's Procortin, here's some prednisone, they need to be given for the life of the dog. So they're not things that you kind of just give once. So it is a disease that's a chronic disease, but it is eminently manageable, and again, needs to be given for the life of the dog. As far as prognosis is concerned, so dogs with Addison's disease actually typically have a normal lifespan with appropriate treatment. That's why you kind of have this smiley guy over here. It does require lifelong treatment. One thing that all veterinarians should talk about, that you should be aware of if you do ever have a dog or you know of a dog with Addison's disease, is that so normally when we're stressed, our bodies respond by producing more cortisol, right? If we have normally functioning adrenal glands. Well, if your dog's adrenal glands don't work normally, it's up to you to give your dog extra steroids if they have Addison's disease in a time of stress. So if you're taking them to the groomers, if you're boarding them, if they're going to a new place, if they're going to the hospital to have surgery, we typically double the doses of steroids in times of stress to help these patients. And I think for all of these reasons, kind of really important to have a good relationship with your veterinarian who can help manage these kinds of situations and help make sure your dog gets treated appropriately. So that's kind of all I have on Addison's disease. Does anyone have any questions or want to talk a little bit further about Addison's disease before we move on to IMJ? Questions? So it's probably 80% are typical and 20% are atypical.
And is there
So it's really, really rare to see it late onset. So usually the ones that are late onset are going to be an atypical dog that's been misdiagnosed. I'm not going to say anything's impossible, but I think most of the time we really are able to make that diagnosis between 1 and 3 because the immune-mediated destruction happens late in life, or early in life, excuse me, and once the adrenal glands are destroyed, they never come back. Was there another question?
When you're talking about the vomiting here,
it can be either. It's typically active vomiting, where you sort of see them retch. There's a difference when we sort of think about vomiting versus regurgitation. So regurgitation is when they don't actually do the thing that dogs do right before they puke. They're just walking and the food pours out. That's regurgitation, and we typically associate that more with esophageal disease, and usually it's more vomiting. Yep.
Sorry, maybe
So Yeah, great question. So we don't really know what causes Addison's disease, and we don't know what causes it in people either. So it's kind of one of the great mysteries of how this disease happens. So what we think happens is there's some predisposition, and that predisposition may be fixed within a breed, right? So it's possible that every single English Cocker Spaniel or every single Standard Poodle has some degree of predisposition to the disease. There's probably some trigger, some which we sort of think of as an environmental exposure, and whether that's a virus that a dog could get subclinically, whether it's a vaccine, whether it's some drug, like we just have no idea. And I'm not saying these things, I'm not sort of saying don't vaccinate your dog, like please vaccinate your dog. But like, we don't know exactly what that, it could be some toxin in the environment that a dog gets exposed to. We just don't know what it is. But we think that's how the disease works. Again, like it's speculation. Like you could throw out anything and I could say it's a possibility. You know, like we just don't know. So it's actually one of the things that I'm looking into doing. I have a grad student who's interested in epidemiology and sort of interested in potentially trying to associate patients with Addison's disease with certain proximity to like Superfund sites, or there's some data that's sort of kind of out there from the EPA, so we can try to see is there something we can help point to the cause. But it's a great question, something we just don't really have the answer to.
If it's something like that, would it clear up, get to the source in any way?
Yeah, so it's permanently damaged. So just kind of, I'm just gonna quickly zoom back to this earlier slide here. So right here, so if you actually look at the adrenal gland of a dog that has, this is a normal adrenal gland, right, where you have capsule, cortex, and then medulla. This entire part of the adrenal gland is like obliterated. So if you look at it under a microscope, it just goes right from capsule, and then this just gets filled by a couple of fat cells, and then it goes right to medulla. So there's no way for that to regenerate. So once the immune-mediated destruction happens, it's gone. I think sometimes I liken it to like diabetes of the adrenal gland. Like once those cells that make insulin in a diabetic patient or a type 1 diabetic patient are gone, they never come back. But that's a great question too. Yep?
From a genetic standpoint, let's say somebody has bred to a dog, and then they've bred there's rural, and later on at say age 5 or 6, the male has been diagnosed with Addison.
Yep.
How do you treat what's come down? Does it have a baseline done on everybody?
Well, you know, so it's a good question. So people have asked, and people have asked me that question before. So you could run a baseline cortisol, and if the baseline cortisol is abnormal, you could do an ACTH stim test, but that doesn't mean that a month from now or a year from now, that dog's not going to develop Addison's disease. Do you know what I mean? It can't predict that it's not going to happen in the future. Given that we typically see Addison's disease develop between 1 and 4 years of age, I think as they get toward the 4 or 5 year mark, it becomes much, much less likely that they're going to develop Addison's disease. But a cortisol test or an ACTH stim test can only rule out the disease at that particular time. It can't predict what's going to happen in the future. Yep. And that's why we're working on the genetics, because the genetics would tell us what would the future hold, right? So
is it considered simple recessive or polygenic?
Polygenic, for sure. Like I think, and I would say the data that we have here comes mostly from standard poodles at this point, because that's where I've done most of the work. But for sure it's polygenic, and I think I have every reason to believe it's going to be the same thing across all the breeds. Yeah. Question?
Any research out there as far as spay-neutered dogs and the incidence of Addison's?
So, you know, I'm not aware of anything that's looked at the incidence of spaying and neutering, but it's a good question. I think, you know, whether or not there's association, I think there's certainly an association in some breeds with being female and developing Addison's disease, but we haven't seen that in some of the breeds that I've studied. So it's an open question, but a good one. Okay, great.
Yeah.
Well, if you have no other questions, I'm going to kind of move on and talk about IMHA and totally kind of switching gears here because it's a completely different disease. And I think this disease in particular is really important for English Cocker Spaniel because it's the poster child breed for IMHA.